Hello everyone, welcome at Studio Free Press Matters. My name is Ruth and I'm your host of today. At Studio Free Press Matters we discuss everything concerning press freedom. And that's very necessary because press freedom is in decline for over a decade now. Journalists worldwide increasingly face physical and digital threats, violence, intimidation, whatsoever. And we need to stop that. We need to stand up for justice and for journalists. So this is what we are going to talk about. Today I have very special guests with me. Lauren Alexander. She is the design tutor of the Royal Academy of Arts in The Hague. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
And we have with us Boris van Westering, program coordinator of Free Press Unlimited of the MENA region. Boris, welcome.
Thank you. And Pakistan.
So art is actually something that is not very much put in one sentence with press freedom. How did you came about to do this project?
Well, we heard about what you guys are doing here at Free Press Unlimited, and I'm actually working at a department called Nonlinear Narrative. So that is a master program at the Royal Academy of Arts in the design department. And we thought that it fits really well with our program, considering that we're thinking about narratives and storytelling, and also critically thinking about media theory and these kind of issues as well, and bringing them into larger research projects for the students, that we really wanted actually to collaborate with you guys. And we met Boris, and then we made a meeting and kind of tossed around some ideas about how we could collaborate over a semester. So that's almost 6-7 months of working together with Free Press Unlimited. So yeah, we started that journey last summer, and we started discussing how we could actually collaborate. So for us, it was a no-brainer that kind of journalism and storytelling actually goes very well with the kind of projects and the whole syllabus that we put together at Nonlinear Narrative.
Great. And how did the project then start? I think it was a kind of a presentation that you gave to the students, or?
Well, yeah, well, after having discussed over and over, like how should which, because we wanted to identify some cases, right, where from the countries in which we work in the Middle East, but also globally, you know, where press freedom is under threat and where censorship is a problem or a challenge for the media there. So we had long discussions also here internally at Free Press Unlimited, like which countries to choose and where we could really select a couple of local partners who could be involved also in this journey, because that was also the reason of this project, to link students from here to our partners in the world where we work. And
An introduction to what press freedom in those countries,
absolutely,
means.
Yeah,
because it's actually not freedom at all.
No, and the purpose was to bring them to the front line and also become meaningful for them, mm-hmm, in the projects that they would work on.
Mm-hmm. And how did they react on their first introduction?
Yeah, well, for us, it was really important also to address the fact that freedom of press and journalistic work is actually endangered here in the Netherlands, but also abroad, because that's probably what the students thought, like, oh, in other countries, you know, they have a much worse situation than what we have, but also actually journalists are under threat here as well. That's also one of the main points that came into consideration when we were choosing our different cases to work on. Mm-hmm. And then Boris did such a great job to hook us up with all the journalists abroad so that we could speak to them directly. So even when we were doing our classes, like half in real life, but also online, we were meeting people from all over the world and kind of exchanging with journalists who were working in all different places, like in Pakistan and Morocco. Mm-hmm. So that was really fantastic that we were able to
do
that.
And did they then interview our partners, or?
Yeah, so what happened is that we did a Zoom introduction meetings with, so we set up, for example, Pakistan, our partner Digital Rights Foundation. She arranged with us like that she would be part of a Zoom meeting, an introduction to press freedom in Pakistan and the challenges out there. And she also made sure that two journalists, female journalists, were also present at this presentation, and they could have a Q&A, but they gave also more proper introduction to what was going on. And that was after the introduction, basically. They could choose which case they would like to take on to work on further. So afterwards, in the case of Pakistan, one student took on the project related to the position of female journalists in Pakistan and tried to do something very meaningful there.
Hmm. So it started last summer. And during the program and the semester, the students were in contact with the partners they choose. So how many students were involved?
I think it's 12 in total. We kicked off the project in September. We did a fantastic kickoff program where we introduced the project, and Boris was also introduced to them for the first time. And then I think 1 month into that, we actually did these more personal introductions where the journalists were online. We didn't actually have anyone coming over in person, but we did speak to people in the Netherlands as well. But we spoke to everyone very briefly, and that was really impressive for the students, I think, to understand like, oh, journalists actually really want to speak to us as well. They're really interested in what we have to say. And they were
quite
flattered.
It was a surprise for them.
Totally. Okay. I think they were really flattered and really inspired by people working in difficult conditions and hearing from people from all over.
Yeah.
And then the students were left on their own to sort of decide what they wanted to focus on, and then they reached out themselves to different organizations, like to JAM News, based in Georgia, and different kinds of organizations who they interviewed in depth about the topics that they were interested in. So
okay.
they took it up themselves.
And this resulted in 6 cases that they worked on? Or countries?
Yeah, I think it was 7 different cases, and then the students worked in groups, and some of them individually, to realize their projects.
Okay, and which one did they choose?
So we had, of course, the Netherlands, and that case was introduced by Paul Vugts, who is a crime reporter of Parool.
About the violence against the threats against a journalist?
Journalists, and there we talked about also Clarice Gagar, the case that was going on, and that led to the choosing of that particular topic. Then there was one student that had her own sources in Hungary, so she took on she had connections in Hungary with the media out there, so she did her own research, which was very interesting. Then Pakistan was chosen and as a case of the killing of a female journalist, Shahina Shaheen. And so Digital Rights Foundation helped her, and it's our partner in Pakistan. Then we had a case of Tunisia about the inclusion of youth voices and how important that is, as the revolution also started with the youth. And
already 10 years ago.
Already, right? 10 years ago, and it was actually at the moment of the 10-year celebration. And Morocco, of course, the case of Omar Radi, who got jailed because of his journalistic work. The students tried to take on this particular topic, how the Moroccan state was actually intimidating and censoring independent journalists. Then JAM News, of course, from Georgia. It was actually a quite interesting case, because at the moment when we were introduced to Margarita, the editor-in-chief, the war broke out between Armenia and Azerbaijan. So she didn't have any sleep, a couple of hours, and she could introduce also about how difficult it is when you report in different countries, different languages, from different perspectives, and how to be unbiased and how to not to take sides, and how the truth is in a war situation is so difficult. And volatile.
And sensitive sometimes.
It's sensitive, very sensitive. So in this particular case, the students were given a case on the
which
spot.
Which they actually could follow live through YouTube or whatever, the news.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Venezuela
was
the last one, probably.
Absolutely. And we were particularly happy also because the colleague of Lauren Niels, also from the Royal Academy, He had also quite a bit of connections into Venezuela, and of course our colleague Mira from Free Press Unlimited also introduced the case of how journalists work inside of a difficult context of Venezuela. And there the students were very clever because they were overwhelmed because of the bigness of what's going on. It's like you have to pin down it to a narrow, small event. And they were able to choose a very small event of an event that happened at the border between Colombia and Venezuela, where the border police or the protesters led to let's say chaos and fire and political turmoil, and this particular case was covered by, of course, the state media, but also by the opposition and activists. So this little story had so many multiple angles of the real story. So they tried to identify, okay, where do the angles of the story, where do they come together, mm-hmm. and where do they differ?
Mm-hmm.
And they have to try to show that this particular in this piece of art, where they show in red, I believe, where it is not matching, or the other way around.
Maybe, Lauren, you can explain.
Yeah, this was
because this is then the end result of...
Indeed, what you see here is a model which would be shown in the context of the exhibition, which is also shown together, and you don't see it in this image, with video material.
Mm-hmm.
So indeed, looking at the narration of the story from different kinds of news outlets, from different perspectives, because of course it was recorded from many sides with many different narratives.
So the
distinctions between what's red, what's indicated on the bridge, and kind of there's a lot of labeling and so on that the students have used as well, but that's to indicate what is disputed and what is not disputed, like what's up for question. So that's the way that the viewer is supposed to read, indeed, the story as they see it in the exhibition space. But this was really such a great success. I have to give credit also to the colleagues of mine who were working together with the students in the workshop. So that's Louisa Riedfink and Judy Vetters, who were helping all of the students actually with the wood workshop and the ceramics workshop as well, to realize all of their different ideas. So this came through many different tryouts of how to arrange and reconstruct the story on the bridge, mm-hmm. and what would actually be accessible, what would be like too much information to give, and how to also make connections between this particular Venezuelan bridge and the story that's going on there, and how it was narrated in the videos, which would also be shown then mm-hmm. in the exhibition space.
Mm-hmm.
So it was quite something actually to bring together all of these different elements. But again, a great learning process in terms of how stories are told and also how the same footage can be used to tell different versions of the same story.
Yeah. Very interesting, and I like it also a lot. So, and what about this one? Because this is about Nagorno-Karabakh, so the war between Armenia and
indeed. So
Azerbaijan.
The whole story was breaking news at this particular moment, and I think one of the things that struck this particular group, so these students, Elvi, Erika, and Paul, they're called. They were kind of looking at how JAM News was telling their stories. So looking particularly how they were constructing their news articles. And one of the things that Margarita pointed out was that they always included a kind of paragraph at the beginning of the article to say where all the sources were coming from. So there was a kind of really unique use of sources and how they were stated in the news writing that they found quite striking. And it also came through the conversations with her that there's sort of, there is no truth in what's being told.
Uh-huh.
They were also surprised that came from a journalist saying that there is no one truth.
I mean, you can only be as a person unbiased as much as you can. I mean, but you still have an opinion, right? So it reflects in a way, always a little bit.
We stimulated them really to also be in touch with people that were also linked to the conflict.
Mm.
Yeah, so how do they read news, and how do they perceive also the other story?
Mm.
And so that's the besides the incredible source of value of GEM News, and how do they report the different angles, and how to deconstruct that. It was stimulating them also to talk about, okay, how do these different parties absorb the news and how do they tell their story?
So that reflects basically this image, right? The different stories about the same area or the same narrative, but still from a different angle.
Yeah, exactly. So it portrays a sort of a timeline of events as they were unfolding. And also important for this project was the online website that they made, an interactive website where they detailed all of these the timeline in greater detail than what you see here in the exhibition outcome.
It still is very nice, and it's actually a beautiful picture. Says it all. This one is also very intriguing, I must say. This is about Pakistan, for the female journalist rights. And it's a kind of a maze, or what is it?
Actually, this was for me a very important story, as when I was in Pakistan last time in Peshawar, I talked to a female journalist, Marmara Afridi, who explained a little bit about how women in society in traditional parts are growing up. And that this is a house, a traditional housing consisting of different houses with a border around it. And there are only a couple of sections where women can go, and and the rest is reserved for men. And all the decision making is a part of the household. Only men can access it. So there is this story about how women are put aside of society and how they are not empowered. And later when we came back, the story, what was striking also is the violence used against women in Pakistan, especially those who voice their opinion.
Domestic violence, you mean? Yeah.
Well, they say it's domestic violence, and the same with there was a case of a female journalist who got killed, murdered because of her work, and they framed it as
domestic violence.
Yeah, honor killing and domestic violence, and which is ridiculous, this framing, because it's not. It is an attack on freedom of expression, and it happens to be a woman.
A way to avoid investigation against that this murder. Yeah, and then, but it's a beautiful piece of art again. And so the end result was presented on the 3rd of May on International Press Freedom Day, or?
Well, we still plan to have an exhibition with all of the works.
Yeah,
we
that
really
would
hope
be great.
That will be possible in the not too distant future. But for now, we photographed all of the works, so they look as if they have been in an exhibition, or at least we set them up very nicely so that we could see what that would all look like.
Yeah.
Photographed them, and so the photographs and the kind of documentation are available online.
Right. So maybe in the near future, Free Press Unlimited can help sort an exhibition out for you and for the students. For now, I would really like to thank the both of you. Lauren, best of luck with the Academy and the students. And Boris, thank you very much for joining us. And I hope, of course, that you will join us again next week on our YouTube channel at Studio Free Press Matters.